Good afternoon. We are here today to announce an exciting new partnership to help us keep more of our students in the classroom throughout the year. Before we continue, I'd like to recognize those who have joined us today for this announcement, including members of the Board of Education, T. Diane Bellamy Small, and Mr. Byron Gladden, as well as members of my leadership team, our community partners, and ambassadors for public education. Thank you all for being here today. Today, we announce the partnership between Guilford County Schools and our partner, Attendance Works, a national organization dedicated to reducing chronic absenteeism in schools. I'm joined this afternoon by the director of Attendance Works, Hedy Chang, and GCS Chief Student Services Officer, Dr. Wanda Legrand, to discuss the details of this partnership. We will hear from both of them shortly, but first I want to take a few moments to explain what we mean when we use the term chronic absenteeism and the reason for this partnership. Chronic absenteeism is students missing 10% of the school year through unexcused absences, but also as a result of doctor's appointments, family vacations, sick days, suspensions, and any other reason students or families have for missing a day or two of school here or there. When we look at it on the surface, a missed day or of school here or there doesn't seem like a big deal or anything to really worry about. However, missing 2 days of school a month adds up. Missing even 5 days could negatively impact a student's academics. In fact, by the freshman year of high school, attendance is a better indicator or predictor of graduation rates than eighth grade test scores. Last year, we launched our strategic plan outlining how we will increase student performance and the overall quality of education for Guilford County School students. We are improving training for new teachers and our veteran teachers, adopting new curricula across the district, and expanding career technical education courses and pathways. But none of these changes will make a difference if students aren't in the classroom to take advantage of these opportunities. How large an issue is chronic absenteeism for GCS? Last year, more than 10,000 students, nearly 15% of our student population, were chronically absent, missing more than 18 days of school. That's 10,000 students who are less likely to be proficient readers, are less likely to pass their courses, and more likely to drop out of high school. On top of that, the students most likely to be chronically absent are those who need the most help. In GCS, the 10 schools with the highest chronic absenteeism rates last year were all high poverty schools. At this point, we don't know why so many students are missing so many days of school. We need to more fully understand the root causes of absenteeism so that we can find viable solutions. That is what Attendance Works is here for us to do, to help us to do. With that, I'll turn this over to Ms. Hedy Chang, the Director of Attendance Works. She will be followed by Dr. Wanda Legrand, Chief Student Services Officer. Ms. Chang, thank you for taking the time to be with us today.
It is my pleasure, and I'd actually like to start by thanking you, Superintendent Contreras, Dr. Legrand, and the school board here for the opportunity to work with the Guilford County Public Schools. Your collective commitment to addressing chronic absence is invaluable. It's invaluable to ensuring that Guilford County Public Schools takes a systemic and sustainable approach to improving attendance, which is actually woven into your district's overall strategy for achievement, especially for the most vulnerable students. We know that separate initiatives on attendance are hard to maintain, but it's when you weave those together that you can have maximum impact. Attendance Works is a is, as you mentioned, a national nonprofit. Our goal is about advancing student success and closing equity gaps by reducing chronic absence. Since our launch in 2010, we have become the nation's go-to resource for improving student attendance. More than 250,000 individuals seek out resources through our website, www.attendanceworks.org. And we operate in over 24 school districts, 33 states, and the District of Columbia, and we have partnerships with over 70 national organizations. Our mission is to ensure every school district in the country not only tracks chronic absence, data beginning actually in kindergarten or even pre-K, but also partners with families and community agencies and public partners to intervene as soon as poor attendance becomes a problem for children or schools. Our strength is that we can help districts, schools, and communities avoid reinventing the wheel. We know a lot about what works from our experience reducing chronic absence in multiple places. And while it isn't complicated, reducing chronic absence does require using the right strategies. Attendance increases when schools and community partners work together with families, using data to activate prevention and early action, and identifying and addressing what are those barriers that keep kids from getting to school. Attendance increases when schools and community partners build strong, meaningful relationships with students and their families, so students are motivated to show up every day and are willing to tell school staff and community partners about what are the things that get in the way from showing up, and so that then the right interventions and supports can be put in place. Families don't share what's happening unless they trust schools and they trust community partners. We also know putting in place a systemic, sustained approach to reducing chronic absence isn't easy, and in order for it to work, this isn't an off-the-shelf approach. This is about taking what we know nationally, but tailoring it to the incredible assets and strengths you have locally, but also to the particular challenges and realities that face the families in your communities. And it's woven again, as I mentioned earlier, into your reform efforts, because when you have it off to the side, this isn't speaking from the experience here, but from what we know from other places, that's when attendance gets disregarded. When it's woven together with the academic improvement is when it works. Now, our partnership with Guilford allows us to bring in what we know from across the country and then work with the district and community project team to determine what needs to happen here in Guilford. Our work will include a discovery process where we find out about the strengths and gaps in existing policies, practice, and communications by interviewing and surveying a variety of stakeholders. We're also going to work with the district around a root cause analysis, where we'll use qualitative and quantitative information to unpack what are the key barriers that children and families face getting to school. And we'll work to create a peer learning network. We'll use the insights we gain from these activities to figure out how do we create a learning network that equips teams from schools to learn and apply effective practices and use your data so you're constantly looking at how can you do this better and how you can build this into the fabric of what happens in schools when kids walk into the classroom and experience their schools every day. We're thrilled to begin this work. I'd also just want to share a few lessons learned that maybe we can take into account as you move forward. What will make a difference is when you can start the school year with prevention and early intervention in place, and you can avoid just focusing on the kids with the most troubled attendance. That's what typically happens. You gotta move from just case management and focus on those most troubled kids to prevention and early intervention from the beginning of the school year. You need to use your data to target where resources are needed most. You again infuse this into existing activities. I will also say, because we have a lot of people in this room, that reducing chronic absence is not a solo sport. And it is not just what happens in schools, it's how the community works together with your schools to address the barriers that kids and families face. My final comment, and I know just because I've had a little chance to meet folks here, but change, including on this subject, doesn't happen overnight. It happens over time. It requires passionate persistence and leadership over time. And we're thrilled to be here because we know that ingredient already exists.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Contreras.
And Mrs. Chang. As you've already heard, Guilford County Schools and Attendance Works will spend the next few months taking a deeper look at the causes for chronic absenteeism in our district, so we may find some of the best and most effective solutions for our community. However, this is not an issue that can wait a few months to be addressed. We need students in the classroom now, and there are some things families and communities can do immediately to help us in this effort. First, do what you can to set school attendance as a priority in your home and your community. That means only keeping your child home from school if he or she is truly sick with a fever or a contagious condition. A common cold or allergies is not a reason to miss school. Avoid medical appointments or family vacations when school is in session. We want to have you there every day. Talk to your students about what he or she is learning in school. Make sure they're engaged in what they're learning and emphasize the importance of going to school every day. If the issue seems to be a more complicated one, such as your student is anxious about school or is showing signs of being bullied, please call your school and work with us to solve the problem. Every student deserves to feel safe at school every day, and we will work with you to make that happen. Avoiding school is not the solution and will only serve to harm your child further. For GCS's part, we will continue to work towards engaging your children in class so they might be excited about coming to school each day. There are more tips and resources available about chronic absenteeism on our district's website, and any family with questions is encouraged to call their school and work with them on the issue of absenteeism. All of this is a start to keeping more of our students in school and on the right path to a brighter future. As GCS and Attendance Works learn more about the causes for absenteeism in Guilford County, we will make the necessary adjustments and work alongside our families and community to find solutions that work for our district.
Thank you, Dr. Legrand. As was just said, chronic absenteeism is a complicated problem that is not unique to Guilford County. But we are working together with our local and national partners to find solutions that are tailored to our students and our community. It will take time, but getting more students in class and learning will be well worth the effort. As you all know, student attendance is a key performance indicator in our strategic plan to help us make sure that students are reading proficiently by the end of third grade, that more students pass Math 1, that we accelerate the performance of low-performing schools, and that we close the achievement gap. This new partnership will help us meet our targets, reach our targets, and meet our goals. I thank you all for being here today, and we'd be happy to take any questions that any of you might have.
Sorry. I just wanted to know, is this something that you've noticed that's been getting worse? Has it been getting better with regards to chronic absenteeism? What has the district noticed?
We have noticed that the attendance data has been pretty steady. That has still been concerning for us to have over 10,000 students missing more than 10% of school.
Might I offer something nationally?
Yes.
Issue we've seen is actually there's a huge challenge across the country in getting accurate attendance data. people have only just begun to really think about this metric in some ways. Before, people thought of it as this kind of paperwork compliance issue, and sometimes it wasn't always attended to. And this is speaking not about Guilford necessarily, but nationally. And actually, so if you look at the few sources of national data, right now the only one is actually the Office for Civil Rights has collected data in 13, 14, and 15, 16. We saw an increase nationally in the number of kids chronically absent, but we believe part of that increase was actually better data counting because people weren't always thinking about it. And they weren't actually, for example, coding suspensions as an absence. That's actually somewhat of a new concept, but it's really helping people think about when kids aren't in class for any reason, then they're not there to benefit, and you need to actually look at all absences. So it is possible, as people get better data collection, you actually see some increases that are related to more accuracy, but unless you have accurate data, you can't use it to take action. I just want to offer that sometimes we see that happening.
Madam Superintendent, do you anticipate that there will be a need for additional personnel to help us once you've identified, you know, what perhaps some of the causes are of attendance? And then the second question is to Ms. Chang. And have you seen that because of the nervousness around immigration that you've seen perhaps more or less, has that impacted our attendance?
So certainly we can always use more personnel, but I think we have to refocus the personnel that we have and utilize that personnel to form attendance teams to better review the data we have to make sure we are effectively and efficiently collecting attendance data, reviewing the data, and then coming up with collective strategies in partnership with community-based organizations to resolve the attendance problems that we see in school. And when I see when I say community organizations, I also mean healthcare organizations. Many of the issues are related to chronic asthma, to diabetes, and other childhood conditions, diseases that are not being controlled but can be controlled if we help families to work with their healthcare providers. And I think if we form these attendance teams in the schools and we focus the efforts, we can better support families who are struggling to support their children.
I want to mention that the way, and it'll get to your immigration question, which in short is, I don't know about the data for your county, but I have seen evidence nationally that there's been, that families, when they're fearful of coming to school because they're worried about immigration, but I've also seen, I think, and again, this is looking nationally because a number of places that have done engage in good practice have also seen some increases, and that's actually the aftermath of Parkland. I think kids are anxious and fearful. And the social media has actually even added to that. So there's fears and anxiety that result in some increases in kids not showing up to school as much. And I think it makes it even more important for schools to take what I call it a public health or a tiered support system approach, where you have to really engage in the positive school climate, the positive relationships with teachers, the making sure that kids feel safe in school and feel that they can connect, kids and families can connect with families when they do have concerns. We just had a chance to visit one of your schools, Asher, right?
Archer
Elementary. I am so sorry about that. And it was remarkable how all of the teachers in that school, one, they build relationships. They know their families in the community. The families know that they're loved and cared for. And it's clear that the teachers naturally talk about, if your kid missed school, this is what they missed, and I want you here. We care about you, and we'll help you. And they have, among your Title I schools, a much lower rate of chronic absence. That isn't about creating new staff. That's about helping every member of school understand the critical role they play in supporting attendance, because they build relationships. They help children know that they're seen, noticed, loved, and cared, and they help kids and families understand what they miss in school when they're not there, and why it's so important to be in school. That tier one engagement is what we've seen as especially critical to really improving attendance.
Hi, so I have a question about kind of the timeline of this. How long is that study period going to be, and then when can families expect to start seeing new policies and procedures in place?
Hedy, you want to start? You want me to start?
So I think the study, what I would say is we guide our work understanding cycles of how schools operate. So my last comment was, you have to begin the year with prevention and early intervention in place. That means you backwards math. We got to make sure we're learning some things, we're doing some things, but you have to have some things in place by the beginning of next year. So we're going to work hard to do a lot of, you know, this school year, we may be able to find some ways to have early quick wins this year, but for sure you have to have a really thoughtful plan that's going into action, because it is harder to get reductions mid-year, because then you missed all the kids, you know, they're already 3-4 months and they're already, you know, you haven't moved that. So we tend to try to think about the strategy in terms of really equipping someplace so that by next year you're launched with a full-on plan for how this will work.
One thing I'll add is, as I mentioned in my comments, we don't want it to wait for a few months. So we started this year by developing for our principals an enhanced data dashboard around attendance. We rolled that out to them this summer so they can have a chance, and we received their feedback on how did the dashboard serve them, and we're able to tweak it for them. And we also provided for our principals, our social workers, and our counselors a tiered approach to supporting families. So some of our families hopefully have felt the touch of attendance already. So if you've missed 0 to 5 days, what does that look like? Will a counselor reach out? Will a social worker or the principal reach out to discuss how can we help you get you to school every single day? So hopefully there's been some touches that have been felt by our parents as early as the start of this school year. We started the school year with those initiatives with our principals this summer.
I am Reggie Holliday with City Help of the Triad, and we lead a growing number of faith partners that is working with GCS. And I have two questions. One, how can the community be involved in this process from the beginning and then throughout? And then to Ms. Chang, how have you seen the community be engaged with the schools, you know, in a very successful or positive way?
So first, I'd like to thank you for your ongoing support for schools. And so many communities, I've seen the faith-based community be a strong advocate and supporter of students and families. And I ask that you continue in that endeavor. In many communities, you serve as a liaison when there have not been strong relationships, to build that relationship between the family and the schools when the relationship has been broken, to actually strengthen that relationship. And I would ask that you continue to do that by getting to know the principals, teachers, and helping to reconnect principals, teachers, and families together. I think that is probably the strongest thing you can do for us, is to help bring families and school personnel together so that we can be more supportive. I think sometimes schools don't understand, or we are often disconnected from the day-to-day struggles that families are having, and sometimes not meaning to be inconsiderate, we are not understanding why a family has not sent a child to school because they don't have the money to go to the laundry. And you know, I can tell you, I went to the laundromat because my washer was broken. I could not believe how much it cost to wash clothes. And I said, who can afford this? who can afford to wash blankets and clothes? And I've thought about how carelessly I've heard people say, wow, they send their kids to school dirty, with their clothes dirty. Well, you know, this is expensive. I couldn't believe how many times I had to go to the ATM machine to take money out just to wash some blankets. And I was thinking that to help remind us what our families are going through, the faith community serves just such a role in that. I cannot overemphasize that. So if you would continue to do that, and if you are having difficulty getting into the schools, please let us know. We will help you to reconnect with the principals. And what would be very helpful is if we helped you organize yourself so that you took on one school instead of trying to help at every school. If the faith community would say, you know, we'll take on Fairview, we'll take on Archer, so that you can really focus your efforts on getting to know the staff and families from a particular school, I think that would concentrate the efforts and really support the students and families in a more strategic way.
So in a number of the places where we operated, the faith-based community has been essential. In Detroit, for example, Reverend Larry Simmons, who is heads up the Brightmoor Alliance, how he chose was to focus on the neighborhood in which his congregation, you know, is located. And they, I would give them credit for us being in Detroit, because in that situation, which I'm thankful is not your situation, there have been so many changes in school leadership that the voice for saying we have to address this issue, and it became because he was so connected to the kids and families in that neighborhood, they created Present in Brightmoor initiative. Now, I will also say that I think the faith-based community, one aspect is they partner with a school or even a feeder pattern of schools because they know those families and they're actually helping to understand the barriers and the issues and the challenges and addressing them. Another approach that we've also seen, and in Grand Rapids actually they did this a bit, is also what the faith community says in their own congregation. Helping this messaging about the importance of kids being there, the importance of forming mutual support efforts to get your kids to school. So if one person is, the adult is sick, then other people will help get their children to school. You know, it really does take a village to raise kids. I think schools are one place where we create villages, but I think our faith communities are another place where we create villages of support and understanding and assistance. And I do think sometimes the value that you play is you can, and I'm just expanding on that, if you know the families in those communities well, you can help schools understand what are the challenges and the issues that they face.
Hi, I'm Adrian Starks. I also work with Reggie Holiday with City Help with the Triad. I'm wondering, based upon the data that you have at hand, that would even grab your attention and see the value of this kind of a partnership. Does it speak to any particular trends? Dr. Contreras, you just mentioned, you answered a question before I was able to answer it regarding health being a factor that can lead to chronic absenteeism. But does the data speak to any other trend that stands out head and shoulders above the rest?
You know, I don't believe our data collection has been sophisticated enough outside of suspension. And we do have data around suspension, and that is a significant part of the chronic absenteeism that must be addressed, particularly for black and brown students. This is going to force us to improve our data collection, but I do know just from my nearly 30 years in the business that we will likely find, particularly in the schools where there are large numbers of students who come from families who are poor, that we will find that much of this is related to health-related issues. So I am happy that we have a partner that is going to force us to improve our data collection so that we can better serve these students and also be more compassionate in the way that we deal with students every day as we learn the issues that our, not just the students are facing, but the parents are facing in just trying to make ends meet and trying to get kids in school. Because I hear so often how these parents don't value education. If you knew what they were going through, just to get them to that school door, sometimes it's actually a miracle that the kid got there. And we would treat them differently if we knew what the parents went through. So we are going to improve the technology and data collection methods, and we'll have a better answer for you as we progress with this process.
Can I offer something from National that might also, another kind of data? So I don't know how many of you have ever heard of the term ACEs, adverse childhood experiences. There is research, I call it the duh research, which is the more ACEs a kid, adverse childhood experiences a child has, the higher their levels of chronic absence. This is not surprising, you know, it makes sense. And if you have one ACEs connected to community violence, violence in the neighborhood, actually that is actually connected to chronic absence. But this is actually to really support what Dr. Contreras just said. So what we know with trauma-informed work is the key is not to say to a kid when something happens, what's wrong with you, but what happened to you and how can I help? Now, I think kids, when they experience trauma, can react in a number of ways. Some react by withdrawing, and you may see it in absences. Some react, and they act out, and you see it in suspensions. And one of the things that I so worry is that we are so accustomed to attendance as a punitive legal compliance process. This is, as a country, attendance has been about you didn't comply with the law, you didn't behave, and it's almost a what's wrong with you. What we're trying to do with chronic absence, which I think everyone in the room can help, is to say, kid missed school, something happened, what happened? And how can we help you? And I think that's the shift that you're trying to make. And then I just offer one other thing. If you're looking, because I think there's this long-term strategy and then there's your short-term wins. That's, I think, what Dr. Legrand was talking about. But one other thing for us to explore more is we know nationally that usually you see chronic absence highest in the transition years. Kindergarten and ninth, and then depends on what happens in middle school. Transition years are also where we know families are more open to help. You know you're going into a different place and you can do it in a really positive way. So it may be that's also a way to think about how you might think about an early win might be in these transition years.
Yes, ma'am.
First off, thank you so very much for understanding the passion. You know, my daughter used to play soccer. Thank you so very much for understanding the passion and the struggle that parents go getting their children to school and somebody else valuing our children when they get there. How are you going to reach out to the medical profession to encourage them to not always schedule these appointments during the school day?
You talk about this. So it's interesting. This morning I had a meeting with Cone Health Foundation, and my team's back there smiling because we've talked about health and their support around attendance, and it just happened that our meetings were together. I believe that the community as a whole, including the health community here in Greensboro and Guilford County, is very open to having those conversations. So when my meeting this morning ended with Cone Health Foundation, they said, as soon as you receive your data from attendance works, let's talk about how we can help. And I said, absolutely. And so there are other agencies as well. I've had the opportunity, since I've just started back in the district in my 90-day plan, to talk about health and wellness in the community. And I bring up attendance and how can we partner together together, and every agency that I've met with thus far, and I think I've met with maybe 37 agencies, and maybe half of them have been health, because health and wellness is a big need for us in the district, that they are open to supporting us and open to coming to the table. So when we, if we bring that to the table as a part of our work from attendance works, I'm sure they'll be very open to it as well.
Hi, again, thank you all for coming and doing this. I was recently at a convention and speaking with other school board members, and the question came up regarding attendance. And one school board member said, well, attendance is the parent's responsibility, period. And I said, well, that's easy to say unless you are, you go to those homes, you communicate with those parents, and you really get an idea of what challenges that they're facing. And so as a school board member, and to encourage other school board members to, you know, get behind and to support the work that attendance work is doing, how can we best support, and how inaccurate is that narrative? Can you speak more to us from your organization, what you've seen, been in the field, as to is that really all that it is, this period? I don't think it is.
Well, I agree it is a parent's responsibility, and it is much more. One of the things that we show is that you can find schools equally low income, and one school has a much lower level of chronic absence than another, but the families that they have are essentially looking at the same. It suggests that there's also something about school practice that is also, and whether schools are welcoming, engaging environments, whether schools have forged partnerships with other agencies, so when barriers come up, those barriers are able to be addressed, whether schools have created relationships of trust that families will tell them when their barriers are absolutely essential. And even if you just took like an example of health. So, kids who have asthma are often more likely to be chronically absent, but it's not always true. What's the difference? Well, one is whether a school on a, on, so it, one issue may be whether the school has a plan for how to address kids with asthma, and whether parents know that there's a plan for addressing kids with asthma. If you have a kid with asthma and you don't know that your school knows what to do when there's a trigger around asthma, you may choose when you're worried about the cold or whatever else that there's asthma triggers. The other issue is that school, sometimes families have almost no access to preventive health care around asthma. And so that's a, not just a school responsibility, that's a school community responsibility. Or if you notice that kids are living in substandard housing, where the housing itself is actually contributing to the respiratory conditions, that's a community issue. That's not about what the kid or family does. Those families may not have any choice about where else to live. And that needs to be then a community problem about improving the quality of the housing. Or likewise, sometimes in schools, folks aren't actually conscious of how to really create an asthma-free environment. What's wonderful about attendance data is that we collect it every day. We can look at it all the time. We can know where it's concentrated, so then we can ask the question, what's not happening here? What might be causing it, and how can we solve that? Just saying it's parents' responsibility does not allow us to be thoughtful and take a positive problem-solving approach.
You know, I was a principal outside, right outside of Chicago, and my school turned out to be one of the highest performing schools in the city, and I had to testify in federal court about how the school became high performing. I would say most of it had to do with building relationships and getting kids to the schoolhouse door. That meant I would get out of my office during the school day, go knock on the door, and say, let's go. You have to go to school. The parents came to the point where they said, I told you she was coming. You knew she was coming. My AP would get in the car. The parent liaison would get in the car. The administrative assistants would get in the car. They knew someone was coming, so you better be sick when I got to the door. We had washers and dryers in the school. We'd wash the clothes. We had a room where you could choose. You could take some other clothes, and we washed the clothes you had. Some wouldn't come to school because the hair wasn't braided. A comb, we'd sit and braid the hair. I braided hair. You had to go beyond. So public education cannot depend on democracy, cannot depend on whether the parents do what they're supposed to do. All of us, our democracy depends on all of us contributing to children growing up to be able to participate as citizens, as residents of this great democracy, if it is to survive. So we all have to make sure that kids have a great education. And with that, we'll close. So, do you have anything?
One last question then. Could you speak to the impact of disciplinary suspensions on attendance? And in Ms. Chun, have you seen in other schools where perhaps systems where they had to perhaps look at policies to help remedy that? I mean, because that winds up being kind of a, you know, touchy subject.
So we know suspensions increase dropouts, increase connections to law enforcement, decrease graduation rates, school failure. They have a negative impact on student academic performance and life outcomes. They do not improve the school's climate, although most people believe that they do. It does improve school climates. And districts that help adults improve relationships with students and find ways to keep students in school and develop social emotional learning improve academic outcomes and life outcomes for students, and we see that all over the country.
And I will say that I think suspension like chronic absence means something's off and you gotta figure out what's and how to solve it, and it's not always the kid. For example, in Baltimore, they actually reduced their middle school chronic absence very significantly by looking at suspensions. Now, what they had to do is you can actually look at suspension codes and you can see why kids are getting suspended. Sometimes it's because there's actually something where there's a worry of physical threat, but a lot of the reasons were not. They were much more discretionary. There were things like kid came not wearing uniform. My favorite suspension, I'm not saying this happens here, but many places suspend kids for truancy. Talk about something that does not make any sense. And then I've heard the kids who are saying, I'm looking for the vacation out by I'm gonna do things that get me suspended so I don't have to be in school. So you have to look at your suspension data, look at what's causing it, look at where it's concentrated. Suspensions also can concentrate in particular places, classrooms, schools. And then you have to go in not in a blaming mode, but what is happening? Maybe what is happening in that classroom is you do have a kid in that, the teacher just doesn't, they're young, they don't know, they don't have the skills, and then you're gonna have to build that skill so they can adapt it. These are warning signs of challenges. And unfortunately, the stigma of suspension has really long-term detrimental effects. And if kids think they were unfairly suspended, it's not just the day they lose because they weren't supposed to be in school. They may not come back the next day.
Thank you.